Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to my talk. My name is Doron Goldfarb. I'm from the Technical University of Vienna, Austria. And I will be talking about the work that we've done about art history on Wikipedia and macroscopic observation. In the last 3 years, me and my colleagues, we've been working on a research project dealing with the, let's say, web-based mediation of art historical content. And I was kind of getting really interested in biographical networks of art historical actors, as I call them. And I will briefly talk about the motivation behind all that and what we did and why we decided to look at Wikipedia, artist biographies on Wikipedia. So as a motivation, dealing with the presentation of artworks or art historical content or artifacts on the web, the context of artworks is very often involves people that are or were not artists themselves. So here is an example that we have a very famous patron of the arts. It was a woman called Isabella d'Este. She was living in Renaissance Italy. And she was a very important patron. And as you can see, there were a number of artworks created by very famous artists that have her as the subject. And if you imagine the traditional way of presenting artworks on museum websites, for example, which are mostly object-centered, you will likely, if you don't know much about art history or about the context of the artworks, miss some information. So it would be a very interesting feature, so to say, to include such social relationships between people, especially also between patrons and artists, for example, in order to foster the understanding of the processes behind art history in general. This can of course be broadened up, and yes, as I said, biographical relationships can be utilized for online presentations of art collections. Here, for example, you have popes and artists that were somehow related to them. And you can imagine that this is kind of a network, a historical network, which is quite big. The idea of networked thinking in art history, let's call it that way, is not new. So this is, for example, from the 1920. It's some genealogy of a so-called Düsseldorfer Malerschule, which was a painting school in Düsseldorf. And it represents a genealogic tree by some anonymous artist, where you see the founders of the school, for example, at the trunk of the tree, and their students, and probably also friendship relations, are the first branches of the tree, and so on and so forth. And then another very famous example for some networked approach to the developments in art history is by Alfred Barr. He was the founder of the Museum of Modern Art in New York. He, for one of the first exhibitions at the MoMA, he designed this diagram that shows the various influential relationships between modern art movements. And actually, you can see that this already takes place in different levels here. This is based on people, and here it is based on movements. In my talk, I will focus on person networks, just to say. So we started thinking about, okay, it would be interesting to mediate or communicate such artist or artist patron relationships, and we were looking for a data source that can more or less deliver such kind of information. And one of the first data source that we looked at was the Getty Union list of artist names. I don't know who of you knows the Getty Union list of artist names, so it's not too many. It's actually provided by the Getty Foundation, which has a research institute that develops currently four different kinds of vocabularies that are dedicated to the this annotation, let's say, of art history artifacts. And one of these is the Union list of artist names, which provides more or less a standardized terminology for annotating artworks with their creators or with personal relationships. And as you can see, we have a variety of writings for Leonardo da Vinci, given as an example, birth, death, place, and date. And interestingly, we also have related people or corporate bodies. Here you can see assisted by, influenced, patron was, and so on and so forth. So this was the first data source that we considered using. Actually, just to give some overview about the data that is present in the UniList of artist names, it's about 178,000 persons and 24,000 so-called corporate bodies, which represent families or firms or, yeah. And if you look at the nationality distribution in the ULAN person records, you will see that the majority of persons who are represented, so I'm focusing on person records now, so the 178,000 person records here, that the majority is of American or British nationality, and then we have French, Italian, German, Spanish, but so you can imagine this is more or less focused on what we call probably the European and American art history. And if you consider the distribution of contributors to the UniList of artist names, so these are contributing institutions, you will see that the majority of institutions who contribute to the ULAN are from the United States, which is no wonder because the UniList of artist names is of course maintained by the Getty Foundation, which is located in Los Angeles. So we have 178,000 person records, and of these I've showed you the distribution of nationalities. A somewhat different picture arises when we start to look at the subset of person records in the ULAN that are actually connected through associative relationships, as I've shown you, like teacher, influenced, and so on. This dramatically changes our distribution of nationalities that are present here. And if we look at the connected component, the giant connected component, which is of interest if you want to provide some continuous option to follow such relationships in the collection, then we arrive at this distribution. And it actually, you can see that it's dominated by French, Italian, and then we have the American and British in place 3 and 4. And since we've seen that the majority of contributing institutions is from the United States, we can probably assume that the proportion of person records who are connected are probably those who are in the focus of the research, of the art historical research that is taking place within these institutions, which might let us assume that this is a picture of the collections of American, mainly American or also British museums, right? So this is, so it's focusing on Italian, French, and American art, let's say it frankly. And you can see that the proportions of German, Dutch, and so on is less. So yeah, as I said, the ULAN relationships are based on the research interests and or the collections of the respective contributors. So we thought about it's just a certain view on the whole. If you try to imagine art history as kind of a process between individuals, and so this is a data source that is provided by one provider, and this might be, as we assume, kind of a filtered from a special point of view. It would be really interesting to see how this coverage or how the coverage of relationships will look like with a crowdsourced counterpart. So in that case, we chose Wikipedia. And Wikipedia is in that respect interesting because it's more and more considered to be a kind of a serious provider of contextual information for art historical artifacts. So there is this GLAMWiki project at galleries, libraries, archives, and museums. For example, the British Museum's work has now maintains a so-called Wikipedian in residence, and so there is a kind of a close work together in order to So both sides will benefit from this. The museum will benefit from additional content, and Wikipedia will benefit from increased quality. And if you consider Wikipedia as a biographical data source, who has ever looked up an artist biography on Wikipedia? So, quite a few. And with respect to relationships, oops, that was one too much, you can see that the relationships of Leonardo da Vinci with his peers, let's call it that way, are kind of embedded in the narrative. So we have, at the age of 14, he was apprenticed with Verrocchio, and his pupils followed him to Milan, and Francis I, the King of France, has become a close friend. And as we can see, it's, of course, only part, so it's not exactly the same. But so the information that is given in explicit form in the ULAN is also present in a Wikipedia article. And of course, sometimes there is more information in Wikipedia, and sometimes there is more information in the ULAN. And I will soon talk about some differences that we've encountered. So, but the problem is, if we want to select a subset of Wikipedia articles which are dedicated to art historical actors, and art historical actors are, as I've mentioned before, not only artists, they can be patrons, aristocrats, clergy, rulers, a wide variety of different persons of different roles. And another problem is that Wikipedia, as some studies have shown, is still problematic with the providing consistent biographical data, if it's about birth, death, dates, roles, and nationalities, because the category system in Wikipedia is more or less like a foxonomy, so you don't have a consistent terminology which describes especially roles and nationalities in that case. And so our idea was, we have actually a very consistent data source, which is the ULAN that we've actually looked at. Why don't we use the ULAN in order to identify articles on Wikipedia that are of relevance, considering that the ULAN only features persons who are relevant to art history? The question is how to get a mapping between the ULAN, and in that case we use DBpedia. I guess most of you will know DBpedia, in order to get these mappings. So in the recent years, there is an initiative by OCLC and the Library of Congress. It was founded by the Library of Congress and the German National Library, actually. It's called VIAF, the Virtual Internet Authority File. It is actually a project which is more or less dedicated to unify biographical records of various libraries around the world into one data set. You can imagine that we have, I don't know, 20, 30, 40 big libraries around the world, and each library maintains a list of individuals, which is kind of in form of database records. Each individual has an ID and several ways to spell the name and so on. And if you want to unify these different records, which are actually very often dealing with the same persons, you have to make some kind of a mapping between these different identifiers. And VIAF is more or less aiming at doing exactly this, providing one ID for a number of records and to cluster these records together. And for doing this, our approach is based on semantic web technologies and formats, and we had to convert the UN list of artist names to RDF. And so most of our research is really would have been really difficult to do without the great work by the Multimedia and 9C eCulture project. I guess that there are some representatives around here in the audience. And so they provided a tool for the conversion of the ULAN, which is arriving in XML data form, into RDF XML. How does it look like if we consider these as separate sets? So we have the big VIAF, which consists of about 15 million unique IDs at the moment. And we, right now, the ULAN identifiers, they are kind of incorporated into VIAF. So it's just 200,000 within this big 15 million. And right now, more and more Wikipedia articles are also getting embedded or introduced into VIAF, which means that VFIDs describing certain persons also include the Wikipedia URI, which is of a big benefit to us because by using the proportion, like we have about 400,000 biographic articles on Wikipedia, and some part of these biographic articles is already included in VIAF, and this is mainly based on a German initiative that tried to include certain person identifiers into Wikipedia articles. And by using this overlap, we were able to identify 18,000 Wikipedia articles that are also in the union list of artist names. I'll hurry up a bit and just skip this a bit. So in the end, we merged the data sets of the subsets that was available to us by using, as I've said, the Wikipedia articles, they are not really consistent with their attributes. So we use the ULAN attributes for describing each Wikipedia article. And for each Wikipedia article, we only use the Wikipage links between the articles, because we are actually focusing on the link structure between Wikipedia articles. So we use the attributes from one data source in order to study the links within the same nodes in another network, which is Wikipedia in that case. And just some brief numbers. So we have the common set of 18,000 artist biographies. And if we just look at it, the ULAN part is really kind of sparse. So we only have 4,460 nodes with minimum degree one, and it's about 9,400 links. And the giant connected component of 2,570 nodes, which consists of 2/3 of the ULAN links within these 18,000 biographies. And it's actually not only artist biographies, so art historical actors. And looking at the same subset, the Wikipedia links between a subset, between these 18,000 persons, you will get a different picture. So it's actually a much larger component and a lot more links that link between these entities. And it's interesting that only about 4,815 links are common to both data sets, although it's almost half of the ULAN links that are present in the data set. If we make a first visualization of the result, you can see in the center, you can see this connected component in Wikipedia. You will see this is the 18,000 person subset with respect to distribution of nationalities. We have 23% American British, so this actually closely reflects the initial distribution of ULAN datasets. So we started looking at the links because being provided with valuable attribute information by the ULAN, we were, for example, able to measure the distances between entities in this data set. So as an example, we have Edouard Manet. He links his article links to Raphael, and it is a distance of minus 349 years. So, and for example, if we now make a histogram of all these encountered link distances, we will see that there are some interesting structural properties within this link distribution. The first thing which jumps into the eye is that the majority of links are covering distances which are between 0 and 38 years, which is more or less what we can define as one generation. And another interesting thing is that 2/3 of the links actually point into the past. It means that there are many more articles for one person who refer to persons who were living before that respective person. And it's very interesting to see that if you compare it to the union list of artist names, it's interesting that the union list of artist names only covers a much more narrow distance between persons, which is related to the guidelines for the creation of ULAN relationships actually tell the persons who enter this information only to enter direct relationships, which means that they only have to allow to enter people who might have direct contact to each other. In contrast to this, as you can see, there are links in Wikipedia which span almost 3,000, 4,000 years. And another interesting thing is that almost all the links in the ULAN are reciprocal, which means for every link from A to B, there is one from B to A. And this is actually not the case with Wikipedia, although in this subset, it is kind of much higher than in general Wikipedia. And if we wanted to, as you've seen this this Wikipedia visualization before, we actually thought that it might be able, that we might be able to provide some visualization where you can see some chronology. So we decided to limit the links that we consider in the Wikipedia to the same range as it is present in the ULAN. And so we ended up with this kind of visualization, which is kind of a chronological visualization of the network of Wikipedia biographic articles. And this is actually really approximately chronologically. So it starts with the Renaissance here. You have dominated by Italians, and there is a small German cluster around Albrecht Dürer. Then we're in Baroque times. We have the Baroque Italians and Baroque Dutch artists and art and patrons and so on. And then is actually there is an interesting development. We have more or less beginning of some British and some French strains, let's call it that way. And they are kind of separated from each other, which is kind of explainable through the historic relationship between these two countries, which was not that good for a long time. And then at the times of the French Revolution, you start to have American nationalities here. So and this this provides some interesting overview. I'll skip this because it's kind of too late now. We put this graphic on Wikipedia. We couldn't resist, and we wanted to see how the people who actually deal with this information think about it, and we got one very nice comment, which actually tells us that it's this the way, like to show the, this distribution of Wikipedia articles might also help Wikipedians to see how the information is present in within Wikipedia, and probably to adapt and to choose which articles probably to add, and in that case. This comment deals with the missing German persons. And so we also did a visualization with the German Wikipedia, and it looks completely different if I tell you that the black color represents Germans, which you didn't see in the English Wikipedia. So, okay, yeah, just a discussion in order to study the linkage between Wikipedia articles. We used biographical attributes from ULAN and focused on Wikilinks. These links between these two datasets differ significantly, and there are because of different foci of the content contributors and also different guidelines for the creation. The Wikipedia links offer additional information that is not present in the ULAN by providing longer time spans, and on the large scale, inter-article links between artistry-related person biographies reveal patterns of cultural interaction. And the feedback to Wikipedians about article coverage might be a valuable benefit of this. Although, I must say, and also with respect to Giorgio's talk, we didn't do a thorough error analysis yet. Thanks for your attention.